morning, and welcome to the Anchor Church, all that you've made it here, and all of you on Facebook. Happy Memorial Day weekend. So we are going to be doing some remembering ourselves. We're going to take communion this morning. We have these famous little fellowship cups, they're called, for the pandemic, so it'll be fun opening them up, and there's little bread and grape juice in there. So we'll be taking communion, we'll be singing about remembering who God is and what he has done. So anybody notice the table, what I have back on the table? You did. Open your eyes. Yeah. So I have Michael, our son-in-law. That's his plane he used to fly. That's an F-18. And it's not in honor of the Top Gun. We're not going to be worshiping Top Gun, but we have... Oh, but it is out this weekend. But Rick's sermon title is called How to Soar. And he will be talking about remembering gives us joy and gives us hope. So let me read to you one of my favorite verses to help us remember. Deuteronomy chapter 6 starts, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These words I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road, when you lie down and when you get up. Be careful you do not forget the Lord. Do what is right and good in the Lord's sight so that it may go well with you." So stand and sing with us as we remember who God is and what he has done for us today. Okay, here we go. And the song sheets are in the back too. Yeah, the blue ones. All right, here we go. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Yeah.
We do tell you that our hearts hunger for only what you can give, and that is your presence. We were without hope until you came for us. In your grace and your mercy, you loved us and you forgave us and you brought us into your family. What an incredible plan you had to rescue us, Lord. I love the line, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Help us to be thankful every day, Lord, for the cost of our freedom, for what you gave up to make us yours, for the hope we have and the joy because of your love and the presence that we have every day. It's truly a gift, Father, and we are humbled. Thank you for saving us. Amen. We'll say good morning to your neighbor and say hi to some new people.
Thank you. Okay, if you could resume your seats as Lori gets the phone straightened out here, we'll get moving along. Just want to let you know that Lauren Yude is doing well. I got and was in touch with him just yesterday, and he's recovering well. He said he's over the hump of his recovery from surgery, but still has a little bit of recovery time to go, so be praying for him. And so let's take a moment just to pray about him and about a couple of other people. Talk to our Father. Father, we do pray for Lauren. We pray that you would that continue to strengthen him and he would continue to recover. We thank you that he's kind of gotten through the worst of the surgery and the recovery from that, but we know he has some time to go, so give him patience. It's hard to be a patient. And give him the ability to just do what he needs to do and to get stronger and get better. And we pray that he and Laura will be back with us soon. So we thank you that things have gone well there. We continue to pray for Cheryl Arnold as she continues her treatments and pray for strength for her and for your comfort for her. And Lord, this morning, we certainly on the Memorial Day weekend, we want to thank you for the many who have sacrificed in our nation for us that have really made it possible for us to live freely and openly. What a gift it is to be free, to be able to worship openly and not without fear. So, Lord, a lot of that is because people have made great sacrifices, and we thank you for them. We pray for those who are in the military right now for your protection of them and for their families. Give them your comfort and strength because we know that what they do is always has a little bit of danger. One of the things that we learned when with Michael, our son-in-law in the Marines, is that even in peacetime, there's a great deal of danger to what they do. And so we pray for them. And Lord, again, our hearts are broken as we think about our freedom and all of that and the good things here. We can't help but think about the horror that has happened in a small town in Texas this past week, and our hearts are just shattered that such a horrible, unbelievably bad thing could happen yet again. We pray for the families there that have lost children, and you know, our hearts just go out to them. We grieve so deeply for them. Lord, certainly evidence that evil is very much afoot in our world, and it's way too present, way too prevalent. And so, Father, in the midst of the evil of this world, we pray that somehow you'd bring good out of this. And we thank you that we can trust in you in the midst of a broken world where things like this continue to happen. We thank you that you have given us good in the midst of it, and we never, ever want to forget. As we remember this weekend, the thing we most want to remember is what you have done for us to give us life and hope. And so we thank you for that, Father, and we pray you teach us more about that this morning as we take time in your word. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. By the way, if you're interested in doing something to help with the families in Texas, Michelle Dastic has got something on the website. It's on the Facebook page, the church Facebook page. If you want to give some money or help in some way, there's some ways to do that there. So be aware of that. Okay, so I've said many times that one of the things I love about my wife is that she's full of joy. And our friend Michael Fueling is a pastor back in Texas. He's been out visiting with us. He always says, he's not in Texas, he's in Illinois. Yeah, that's right. Thank you, Lori. Has said, you know, he just said, you know, Lori is amazing. His observation, he says she brings joy to every place she comes, and I think that's true. One morning recently, we'd gotten up. It was a little early. We were getting breakfast ready. It wasn't elaborate. Lori was making some oatmeal. And, you know, she'd had a couple of really busy, tough days, and she wasn't really operating at 100% efficiency. And so she's standing there at the stove, got this oatmeal going. I was next to her because I had washed off some blackberries, and they were in the sink over here to my left. And so Lori, as I reached up to the cabinet to get a bowl out to put in the blackberries, there were a couple of bowls that Lori had already gotten out for the oatmeal. And so I'm reaching out for this bowl, and Lori just points to the bowls on the counter and goes, So I just thought, man, that's really articulate. I didn't say anything. But I pointed to the blackberries, and I said, And I said, what happened? I married a cave woman? You know, that's the best. That's how we're going to communicate now? Grunting? And she just started, doubled up in laughter, laughing so hard she could hardly breathe. And all I had to do, just the rest of the day, I'd go along and go, and she'd start laughing again, you know. And I love that about her, that she just laughs so easily. Joy, it's a beautiful thing. A man named William Treadwell, in an article in Leadership magazine, said about Christians, if we can convince people that we are onto something that's full of joy, they'll stampede one another to follow us. Because people want joy. Everybody wants joy. So today we're going to think a little bit about laughter and joy. So we spend some time looking at Psalm 126. We're going to take a week off from our study we've been doing in the book of Romans. In honor of it being Memorial Day weekend, I thought this would be a good time, Sunday, to think about remembering. And that's what we're going to look at in this psalm. Psalm 126 says, when the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter and our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev. Those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Those who go out weeping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with them. So let's start with this. God wants us to be joyful. We can see that in this psalm. This psalm, actually, you might, if you had your Bible with you, you'd probably see it has a title that says it's a song of ascents. All of the psalms in this area of the psalms have that title. They're songs of ascents. It's from Psalm 120 to Psalm 134. It's a series of psalms that the Jewish people would sing as they were traveling to Jerusalem for their feast days and holy days to celebrate them there. And this particular song of ascent was a psalm of remembrance. Appropriate for us today because it's Memorial Day weekend. So this psalm recalled what happened after Israel had been in exile in Babylon for nearly two generations. Israel initially had consistently failed to live by the covenant that God had made with them back time of Moses, you know, on Mount Sinai, made the covenant, and then Israel just pretty consistently failed to live by that covenant. Of course, Israel's greatest king, when they finally got a king, their greatest king was David, ruled beginning around 1000 BC. And then his son Solomon succeeded him on the throne. And then Solomon's son, David's grandson, Rehoboam, succeeded Solomon. And Rehoboam was a very poor leader. He had a lot of really bad ideas, which caused a revolt. And that led to a civil war, and the nation ended up being split into two countries. The northern tribes were called Israel, and the southern tribes were called Judah. Now, Israel in the north just had consistently really awful leadership. The kings were terrible. And so the whole nation basically lived in rebellion against God. And God sent repeated prophets to them, telling them the judgment was coming, and they didn't listen. And finally, in 722 B.C., the judgment arrived in the form of Assyria, which just totally destroyed the nation of Israel. Judah continued because they had better leadership mostly and did a little better with following God's law, but pretty consistently they also wandered, rebelled, and God sent them prophets, said judgment is coming, and finally it came. In 605 BC, the Babylonians arrived and routed Israel. The Babylonians ruled them for about 20 years, and in the midst of that time, they rebelled again against Babylon, and the Babylonians in 586 BC just absolutely destroyed the nation of Israel. I mean, You read now in the newspaper about all of the things that are happening in Ukraine, and you read about the devastation there. What happened with Israel actually ended up being worse, where Judah was worse. There was basically the city of Jerusalem, there wasn't one stone left on top of another. I mean, they completely destroyed the city and the nation of Israel. Now, when a nation conquers another nation, there's always the what now problem. Okay, you've beaten them, but what do you do now? How are you going to rule these people? How are you going to control these people who now hate you for what you've done to them, if they didn't hate you before? And, you know, I've wondered that about Russia's invasion of Ukraine. I keep thinking, you know, I mean, when that first started, like most people, I thought, well, Russia's just going to walk right over Ukraine, but then what are they going to do? How are they going to rule? Because the Ukrainians hate them. And it seems apparent that they must have gotten some very bad intelligence because they thought that the Ukrainians were going to welcome them, which clearly they have not. So back in ancient times, that what now question, there were two basic methods that people, countries used to answer that question. What are we going to do with this country that we've destroyed? The first one was what I would call the nuclear option. They didn't have nuclear weapons, but it had the same effect. It was basically kill them all. We'll destroy every living thing in this country and that won't be a problem anymore. That's obviously very violent. So they came up with a different option that often was used, and it was the one Babylon used when they conquered Judah, and it was the relocation option. And what they would do is they would kill the most troublesome people. But then the others that were maybe had some leadership ability or they saw something and then they would just relocate them. They would move them out of their homeland into a place where they were going to be a minority, a small minority. And that's what they did with Judah. They moved them to Babylon. And, of course, the prophets of God had told Judah, this is exactly what is going to happen to you. Babylon, the Babylonians are going to take you and they're going to move you to the city of Babylon, their capital, and you're going to live there, Jeremiah said, for 70 years. So all that happened in 539 BC. Babylon itself was conquered by the Persians. And shortly after that, the Persians had a ruler, his name was Cyrus, and he did something that was very strange. He said, all of you Jewish people who are living here, you are free to go back to your homeland. Very surprising, because the Jewish people, Israel and Judah, had really kind of been a problem for Assyria first and for Babylon. That's why they conquered them. And they'd been a problem for a lot of their neighbors. They'd been a thorn in everybody's side. So, you know, Babylon and then Persia has control of Israel now, and they pretty much got them in a place where they're not going to bother anybody anymore. So why would Cyrus say, you know what, now you can go back and give them the possibility of rebuilding and once again becoming a problem? Why Cyrus made that decision is really unknown in history. It didn't make any sense because nobody else did that. Typically what happened when a nation conquered another nation and used the relocation option was that those people would go off into another part of the world and basically would be absorbed into that culture, and they would never again be known in history. They would just basically disappear from history. But that didn't happen with the people of Judah, with the Jewish people. Cyrus, you know, why he did that? No one really knows, except those of us who read the Bible. We know God decided what Cyrus would do. It was God's plan for Israel to go back, and so they did. Cyrus didn't force the Jews to leave. He decreed that any who wanted to could go back. And 42,000 of them left and went back. Later, there were two more groups that followed. And actually, this is a fairly remarkable thing, because it had been 70 years since those deportations to Babylon had begun. And so anyone who was over the age of maybe 10 when that started, by this time, is either very old or dead. And all of those, rest of those people, the overwhelming majority of the 42,000 that went back, had never lived in Judah or Israel. They had been born in Babylon and lived their entire lives there. Their home was Babylon. The culture of Babylon was their culture. That's what they knew. And yet, they made the decision to leave their home and go to back to Judah to rebuild. You know, Babylon is roughly 500 miles away from Jerusalem. And so back then, the way you got from point A to point B was you walked. The airline service was really bad there. So you're talking about more than a month-long trip on foot to make that trip, which means these people, when they left, mostly were thinking, we're never going back because the trip is too long and too hard. And so they're leaving their homes knowing this is it. This is a permanent move for us. Lori and I recently watched a television show that depicted the efforts of a group of people in the late 19th century to move, to immigrate out west in a wagon train. And it reminded me, when I was a kid, there was a TV show called Wagon Train that we used to watch. And I don't remember much about it. I remember it was on the same about the same time as another show called Rawhide. You remember Rawhide, any of you old? The only things I remember about, I think Rawhide, it got its name from what happens if you ride too long on a horse. You get a rawhide. But about all I remember from that show was the song ended with this rawhide, you know, forever. And then the other thing I remember about it was Clint Eastwood was in that movie, in that show. After it was over, rumor has it that he went on to get some other prominent roles in Hollywood. Go ahead, punk, make my day, you know. But anyway, back to Wagon Train. The show that Lori and I watched was a lot grittier than the show that I remember from my childhood. It showed the real hardship of trying to make that move in those days. It was grueling. There was a lot of suffering. People died, a lot of them. And those who didn't die suffered a lot. And they went through all of this hardship, and when they arrived at the place they wanted to go to, they got to something that was just raw land. And they had to build a home with their own two hands, and they had to plant crops and grow the crops. And somehow, before those crops came up, they had to somehow get food off the land, live off the land, to be able to just survive. And one of my main reactions from watching that show was, I would have died, you know? Build anything? I can't build anything, so I wouldn't have had a home and, you know, live off the land. For me, living off the land is going to the grocery store, you know? It would have been tough. So here's the thing. These people who left the cosmopolitan city of Babylon, really the center of culture in their world, they left that cosmopolitan city to go through that kind of an ordeal to get to a place where there basically was no infrastructure left whatsoever. Man, this was a tough decision to make. And it's astounding to me to think that thousands of those people made that decision. They clearly had kept alive a dream. The dream of what God's people should be and of the chosen, the promised land. And you see that in this passage. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dreamed. So there are two aspects I want you to see here in this about their attitude towards this very difficult endeavor. And the first is that they were amazed at what God had done for them. We're like those who dream. They kept saying, I can't, can you believe this is actually happening? You know, we know what it's like to be men who've dreamed. We've all had dreams that are vivid, memorable, sometimes bizarre. Lori told me recently that she had a dream. Lori and I both have church dreams every now and then. You know, this one was really weird. She had a dream where everybody came to church buck naked. I don't know what that says, but I'm pretty sure that's not what this psalm is talking about. Not long ago, I had a dream that I was not an old man. I was a young man, and I was playing baseball in the major leagues, and I was just about to come to bat in the in a crucial game, ninth inning, bases loaded. And then I woke up, you know, and it was kind of disappointing. I was liking it. Well, you know what? These people were saying, we had that kind of a dream and it came true. This marvelous, unbelievable dream. We get to go back to our homeland. Who gets to do that? Nobody. These people had been in exile for 70 years. How could this happen? They didn't have, you know, when Jeremiah came along and he said, you're going to be there for 70 years and then you're going to be allowed to go back to your homeland. That didn't happen anywhere. Didn't happen anywhere else in history. And they couldn't imagine, how are we going to make that happen? You know, or, I mean, we don't have the power, the ability to force a ruler to send us, set us free. Is there going to be another Moses-like leader that's going to come along and say to the king of Babylon or later Persia, let my people go? Are there going to be miracles like there were in Moses? How's that all going to happen? They had no idea. But it didn't make any sense to them that someday Cyrus, the ruler, was going to just wake up and one morning go, you know what? I have had a great idea. We should let the Jewish people go. And that kind of thing didn't happen until it did. And they were very clear about how that happened. The end of verse 2, not only the Jews, but everyone in their world of that day said, the Lord has done great things for them. It is the Lord who did this because there is no other explanation for how this has happened. Scholar H.C. Leupold wrote, no god of the ancients was ever known to have achieved the restoration of his people after their deportation. And the ancient Jewish people never forgot that. And when they wrote songs to sing as they marched up to Jerusalem for the holy days, they would sing these words. The Lord restored the fortunes of Zion. We were like those who dreamed. He'd done something incredible for them. So no matter what else might be going on in their lives, they said, we must never, ever forget that the Lord has done great things for us. We shouldn't even exist anymore as a people, but we are here because the Lord has done something great for us. And that's something that we as followers of Jesus Christ need to do. God has done something wonderful for us, something we could never have done for ourselves. Only God could have done this. He has made possible the dream of us becoming his adopted children, of being forgiven of all of our flaws and all our failings that we're all so very much aware of, and giving us eternal hope, eternal life. And these are precious gifts that we could never have obtained for ourselves, but through Jesus Christ, his Son, God has done this for us. We were like men who dreamed, and the dream has come true. We have been given this incredible gift. We must never forget that. But when something like that, so good, something so amazing happens like that, not only do you never forget, but there's an emotional response that's natural to human beings. And that is, verse 3 says, we are filled with joy. You know, that's the normal response. When something incredible, something wonderfully good happens, you have joy. And joy is a theme in this psalm. It shows up. There, our tongues are filled with songs of joy. And then verse 3, we are filled with joy. And then verse 5, those who sow with tears will reap with songs of joy. Then again, verse 6, will return with songs of joy. Over and over again, you see the repetition of the concept of joy. God thinks joy is a really good thing. God wants us to have joy. You know, people tend to think of faith and of religion as a serious thing, and in some ways it is, but it's not a somber thing. In Christ, it's a thing of joy. Job 38:7 says that when God laid the cornerstone of the earth's foundation, the morning stars sang together and all the angels shouted for joy. The heart of creation is joy. In his book, Secrets in the Dark, the late Frederick Buechner wrote, "The world is full of darkness, but at the heart of darkness, who would have believed it? There is joy unimaginable." Galatians 5:22 lists the fruit of the Spirit, and one of the first ones is joy. Romans 14:17 says, "The kingdom of God is about joy." You know, maybe you've seen some of the TV depiction of the life of Christ called The Chosen. One of the things, Lori and I have watched it, and one of the things that I've really enjoyed about it, I think Lori has too, is the way they represent Jesus. He comes across as very real, very human, and he's got a smile on his face a lot. He loves playing with kids, and he loves teasing his buddies at times. He has a great sense of humor, and if you study the life of Christ and you pay attention to the things he says, you'll notice he used humor a lot. And I love in the show, they show him as someone who liked to laugh. It makes sense because in John 15:11, he said to his men, and remember, this was on the night before he was going to be arrested, very serious time. He says, "I've told you these things that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete." Well, okay, that wouldn't be very appealing if Jesus, if you said, "Well, hey, you can have joy like me," which is to say, not at all. No joy whatsoever. Oh, well, great. Well, that's something to look forward to. It would be appealing to them because they had seen Jesus' joy. They'd seen his upwelling, unending joy coming out continually in his life. And they said, "Yeah, I want that." And then he said, I want that your joy would be complete. You know, what does it mean for joy to be complete? For reasons I don't fully understand, Toby and Anna are, you know, son and daughter-in-law, and their girls all love the two Guardians of the Galaxy movies. Honestly, I've watched them and I don't quite get it, but they love them. And one of the funny things about that is the central character, main character in those movies, has this old tape, a cassette tape, which he carries around with him, and it's a cassette tape of oldies, old songs. And so he listens to these oldies all the time. And what's really funny is our 6-year-old and 4-year-old granddaughters always want to listen to these old songs, you know? So they went, "Oh, play the Guardians of the Galaxy." So, you know, they're listening to Hooked on a Feeling, you know? "I'm hooked on a feeling, high on..." But, you know, what? And the Pina Colada song, "Hey, you like Pina Colada." And here's our little granddaughters loving these old songs that were popular when I was young. Very young. "Spirit in the Sky," that's another one. Love that song. But anyway, here's the thing. Why am I talking about it? Well, Toby is working on getting a complete set of the Guardians of the Galaxy figurines. There is such a thing. They've made toys from this movie, and he wants to get a complete set, and he's pretty much there. And when his set is complete, what does that mean? There is no more. He's got all there is. So when Jesus said, "What I want is for my joy to be in you, your joy to be complete," he's saying, "I want you to have so much joy that there is no more than what you have. You have all that there is." That is what Jesus wants for us. Lori and I spent a few days this past week out in the desert. We got to have a little getaway because it's been a very fast-paced year for us, and we needed a break. So we had an opportunity to go out to the desert and get fried. But the place we were staying had several different swimming pools. They had one for the kids that we went, no, we'll not go there. So Lori said, yeah, we wanted to go in the pool where we could stand in the water in the 100-degree heat with all of the other retired people. You know, it's kind of funny. But they had, next to the swimming pool, they had an outdoor recreation area. It's covered, and there was a pool table there and a ping pong table. And so every evening, because evenings were beautiful there, we'd go swim, and then we'd play pool. And I actually was, you know, at first I was a little better than Lori at the game, you know. But our results of our games were pretty much even, because I kept making mistakes, you know. I'd be winning the game, and then, there's the eight ball. No, end of the hole. I just lost that game. But then one night, Lori suddenly caught fire, and she won two games in a row. The only two games we played that night, she beat me. So the next morning, we're out standing in the pool, and she said to me, you know, Rick, you're so good at losing. And, you know, what she was talking about was, she was saying, you know, of the two of us, she's way more competitive than me. And she doesn't like to lose. Whereas I kind of go, yeah, whatever, you know, I don't have anything invested in this. Lose, win, doesn't really matter that much. And so she was trying to be a complimentary, saying, you know, you're so good at losing. And I said, well, after all these years, you finally recognized that I'm a loser, that what I'm really good at is losing. And she just started laughing so hard. We're sitting actually in the steps in the swimming pool, and she just literally doubled over, can't breathe. She's laughing so hard, and it went on and on, because I just kept saying, well, you know, I guess it's good to be good at something. I guess I'm good at losing. That's something, right? And she'd start laughing again, and went on and on. And it was funny. I could see people kind of looking over, going, I wonder what's so funny. Why are those two having so much fun over there? Because they're all kind of just standing there going, and then there's this woman over there just dying in a pile laughing. And I thought, you know what? Lori laughs because she's full of joy. I don't know what she's doing over there right now, but she spilled her water. Okay. That's the way Jesus wants us to be. Oh, so Lori is the model. We all want to be like, no, not necessarily like Lori, but full of joy. Joy is one of the products of God's work in people. That's the kind of joy that Jesus had. God's spirit at work in people is going to make them not dour, frowning, negative, judging, critical. It's going to fill them with joy. Bishop Columba Marmion said, joy is the echo of God's life in us. And here's the thing. We can't grit our teeth and try to be more joyful. That doesn't work. If we say, okay, you know what? He's right. I gotta be more joyful now. It comes across as phony and hollow, because it is phony and hollow. How do you get joyful? How do you, the way you have joy is, you have joy, and joy is a reaction. You have joy because something wonderful has happened in your life, and you have something to be joyful about. And so the way we experience more joy is remembering, which is what this psalm tells us we need to be doing. Remembering what God has done for us and how incredibly good it is. And that will produce the joy. So that's the first thing we see in this passage. The second thing, the second half of the psalm, first half looks at the past. The second half looks at the future. Starts there at verse 4, restore our fortunes, Lord. So they start remembering how God restored fortunes in the past. And now it looks forward and saying, God, would you restore our fortunes in the future? God's work isn't confined just to the past. So yeah, God did some great things, and that's really good. We'll remember that. they're saying, we expect God to do some great things in the future. And that was important because the going was not always easy for the Jewish people of those ancient times. You know, the people who had been left in Judah after the Babylonians destroyed the nation, they were left destitute. There was no infrastructure. They had nothing. And it was all they could do to just struggle to just survive, get by one more day. And so they weren't anywhere close to having the resources to begin rebuilding a nation. And now thousands of people, capable, energetic people, have arrived from the Persian Empire full of big plans and dreams. And they set about the task of restoring the city of Jerusalem, rebuilding the temple, rebuilding the walls. And they made a great start. They started off and it was wonderful, but all you have to do is read the books of Ezra and Nehemiah and Haggai to find out it didn't last. The task that they took on would have been hard no matter what happened. But to add to the degree of difficulty, they faced opposition. Neighboring countries didn't want any part of them rebuilding their nation. And so they opposed them at every turn. And so here they had few resources. They had a difficult task, and they got people trying to stop them. But the biggest problem for them was something I would just call distraction. It wasn't long before the returnees began to grapple with the same thing that the survivors had been dealing with for 70 years, just trying to survive. They began focusing on, I got to build my own home. I've got to build, plant my own crops. I got to take care of myself. I can't be spending time building a wall or rebuilding a temple. I got to get by myself. And so it wasn't long before the whole project of rebuilding Jerusalem just ground to a complete halt. And Haggai chapter 1, verses 2 through 4, it's been years since the exiles first returned, and now the work had ground to a halt. And Haggai delivered a message from God. It says, "These people say the time has not yet come for the Lord's house to be built. Then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai, 'Is it time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin?'" That's what happened. They got distracted by trying to take care of themselves, and then that became the focus. And they began building nicer and nicer estates and homes and paneled homes, back then a sign of luxury, and never ever got back to the main task of rebuilding the city of Jerusalem and especially the temple. This psalm that we're looking at was written in a down time, and we must not miss the message. Restore our fortunes. Their fortunes needed to be restored because they were having hard times. And he says, "Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev." The Negev is a desert in southern Israel, and it's arid, obviously. It's a desert. It has a lot of wadis, dry stream beds. Lori and I saw a lot of those, as we were driving through the desert. We were around in the desert. You all know, if you've seen it out there, we have them here in San Diego even, areas where, it looks like there was a stream there once, but now there's just sand. But we all know what happens when there's an El Nino year, and all of a sudden it turns into Seattle. It just rains all the time. And what happens? Well, all those wadis become raging streams. And the psalmist is saying, make our lives like that. They're now dry stream beds. Fill them with water. Bring them back out to life, Lord. Simple, a symbol of something lifeless being restored to life. That's what the psalmist is doing here. And this is a reminder that the God who once did great things for Israel is still the same God who wants to do great things for his people again. What happened with the ancient Jews can happen to us. We get distracted too. We get so caught up in just our little lives and the grind and the routine that can wear us down. And life becomes dry and dull and hard, and our enthusiasm and our joy disappears. And that's not how God wants us to live. God wants us to look forward with hope and be saying, God, you're here. Restore our fortunes. One of the most familiar passages in the Old Testament is Isaiah 40, verse 31. Those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles, and they will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. That is what God wants for us. I know English, such a weird language. Aren't you glad that we didn't have to learn it as a second language? Man, it would be so hard. You know, I'm amazed in watching our little grandson, two-year-old Wesley, learning to talk, and he's just talking up a storm. And he's, you know, every now and then, he loves to, what you doing, Nana? You know, what you doing, Nana? What's the baby doing, Nana? You know, and then every now and then he'll come up with, what's Papa doing? You know, or what's Papa up to? That's the one that I thought was kind of funny lately. What's Papa up to? You know, but Lori observed recently that little two-year-old Wesley, he sometimes doesn't get word order right. He's kind of like Yoda, you know, things get out of order. But but I thought, this poor little guy, he's got to figure out the English language. And English has all these words like sore, you know. Great thing about, you know, the word sore. There's a problem with the word sore, right? I've got one on my foot, a sore, S-O-R-E. Means something very different than the word S-O-A-R, but they sound the same. You know, sore on your foot hurts. It means pain. It means being mad or something. The other word means something completely different. Soar means to fly, to glide up into the sky. And, you know, Isaiah used a picture of like an eagle. We don't have a lot of eagles here, but we got a lot of hawks, and they soar too. And you watch those things, and they're up in the sky. Have you ever watched them? Up there, and they're just riding along on the thermals, and they're not flapping their wings or anything. They're just gliding, just whew. And they're looking down for prey, of course, but you know, it's just amazing to watch those things. It's what God, that's how he wants us to live. I love the idea of soaring. A number of years ago, Lori and I had the memorable experience that I told you about before, that we were on Maui with our adult children who didn't have any, we didn't have any grandkids at that point, and we were on vacation. At the end of that trip, we did something unique. We've never, ever done anything like this. We rented an airplane, and our Marine pilot son flew that airplane, flew us in an aerial tour of Molokai, Lanai, and Maui. And I just remember taking off in that little four-seat airplane. You know, I always think it's kind of fun when you take off in a jet because, you know, the power and everything, and you feel the acceleration. In that little airplane, man, you really feel when you take off, all of a sudden it's like, whoa, we're going up. Here we go. We're taking off. And you fly up, you know, and we flew up over the beach, you know, out over the ocean. And Michael is looking down and he's going, hey, look at the turtles. And we're going, what turtles? He has way better eyesight than we do. It's like, I see the ocean. But anyway, it was just cool, that sense of just floating along in the sky. And Isaiah says, this is what God wants. He wants us to soar through life. Doesn't mean that we won't ever have hardships. These people had hardships. They needed their fortunes restored. But in the midst of it, Isaiah says, if you put your hope in the Lord, which is what they were doing, they're asking God to restore their fortunes, to restore them to life, these dry stream beds. This is what God wants. And as we hope in him, he says, we can soar. And every one of us wants to soar in life. So what do we do with this? Application. How do we go about applying these truths in our lives? Well, okay, so first thing, joy, remember this, joy comes from remembering. That's the critical thing here. Trying to be joyful will never be effective. Joy is an appealing thing. We want it. All of us want it. Everybody wants it. But the thing about joy is you either have it or you don't. You can't just go, oh, you know, I've got a little bit of joy. I think I need some more. I'm going to grow my joy. Joy is a response to something good and remembering something good in your life. Most recently in our family, we were filled with joy when our latest grandson, little Hunter, was born 3 weeks ago. And it was, you know, it was an interesting weekend for us because we got a call in the middle of the night. Oh, Carissa's water just broke. We got to go to the hospital. We need help. And so Lori had to get up and go over and take care of little Wesley while Michael and Carissa headed to the hospital, and she delivered the baby that morning. But what that meant was then on Sunday, Lori wasn't available to be here. And you know what? Lori brings a lot of energy, and she makes things a lot more fun here. And Jerry took over and led worship, did a great job. But for me, it's just harder when Lori isn't here. It's just, it's more effort in a lot of ways. It's just, I don't have quite as much energy when she's not here. I think I'm a leech. I suck energy from her. Anyway, but here's the thing. Interesting thing on that morning, I had so much joy. And it wasn't because, oh, this is great. Lori's not here. Now I can really cut loose, you know. And no, it was, I had joy because something so wonderful had happened in our family. Just happy about little Hunter being here. Yay! The good thing became the thing that produced the joy even in the midst of harder things. And that's how life is for us. That's how we have joy in the midst of the hard things. It's by remembering. The Lord has done great things for us. Life will have its disappointments and its tragedies, but God has done a miracle for us in Jesus Christ. He has wiped our slate clean. He has adopted us as children. He's given us his Spirit. He's given us a new life. He's given us eternal life. How much would those things cost if you could buy them? Well, there's no way you could buy them because there's no amount of money that could ever pay for such incredible gifts. And God has given them to us freely through Jesus Christ. We have something to remember, God has done great things for us. And that is what brings us joy. So remember that. Remember the great things God has done for us. That's what produces joy. And then soaring, remember, according to Isaiah, comes from hoping in the Lord. And the last Sunday was a long day for Lori and me. We started early getting ready for church. You know, we have to bring the equipment here. Fortunately, Vince brings the drums, so we don't have to worry about that. But, you know, the keyboard and all of the other paraphernalia and the guitar and amps and, you know, all that stuff. It's our car is just getting beat to death because we transfer all this stuff. And we have to get here early and we have to set it up and then we have to rehearse. And it makes for a long morning. We're very tired. And then we had lunch. And then that last Sunday, after that, Lori and I packed. We hadn't done a thing to pack. And then we got in our car and we drove out to the desert. 2 hours, 2 hours, 15 minutes out to the desert. Checked in our hotel and it was really nice. We had a lot of fun. Went to the pool, you know, and it was great. That night, I woke up in the middle of the night, you know, and you're in a hotel room that you're not familiar with. I woke up and it's dark and I had to go to the bathroom and I knew the general direction of the bathroom. It's over there. Okay. So I got out of bed and I started heading for the bathroom, and on the way to the bathroom, I just slammed into something that was in my way. I mean, just bang, and there was this sound, went boing, boing, you know, and I thought, what's going on, you know? Well, what I had forgotten, and that, you know, because I wasn't familiar with the place and it was dark, I didn't see it, was that there was a half wall that divided the bedroom from the bathroom, and I had just walked right into that half thing, and there was a doorstop, you know, one of those springy doorstops. I had kicked that, and it was boing, you know, and it was just this shocking, like, what's going on? What is this? What have I done? You know. It was disoriented because you're kind of only half awake, you know. Lori, all she could go is, what was that boing noise, you know? The next morning I was thinking about that and I thought, you know what? I've had experiences like that in life where I don't know what's going on. I'm trying to get through life and all of a sudden I just get blindsided by something. And how am I supposed to get through life when stuff happens like this? Well, here's how you get through it. You remember God is with us. We can ask him to restore our fortunes, to fill our dry stream beds with torrents of water, life unending. Jesus said his spirit would be like rivers of living water flowing within us. We say, Father, restore that stream of living water, restore our fortunes, and I'm going to put my hope in you. I'm not going to try to hope in, oh, my circumstances are getting better. Oh, hope I get this, hope I get that. You know, it's fine to want for better things in life, but that's not where the streams of living water come from. They come from putting our hope in the Lord. The way we experience that hope, the way our souls can soar, is to not trust in our ability to control life, not trust in our ability to get things that we want, or in our own power or resources or money. It's to put our hope in the Lord to work in our lives, use us for his purposes and his glory. Alexander Solzhenitsyn lived through more hardship than we can ever even imagine. He was a big supporter of the communist regime in the Soviet Union back before World War II and during World War II. But he began to see problems with the leadership of Joseph Stalin. And so at one point he wrote a letter to a friend and he discussed some of his concerns and some criticisms of Stalin. He was arrested and sentenced for 8 years in a prison camp because of criticizing Joseph Stalin in a letter, private letter to a friend. So he was sent to a Soviet gulag for years. And the life that he experienced there was beyond grueling. It's unimaginable. Of course, Solzhenitsyn wrote about his experiences, became a best-selling writer. But at one point while he was in the gulag, he became so discouraged, so defeated, so hopeless that he said, I don't even want to try anymore. He decided he was just going to give up. And so he decided one day, that's it, I'm done, I can't do it anymore. And his plan was, they sent them out every day to work out in the fields, this labor camp, you know. And he said, I'm just going to stop while I'm out there. And he knew what will happen is the guards will see him and they will come and he said, they'll beat me to death and that's how I'm going to end my life. And that day he started to carry out his plan. He got out there and everybody's working and he just stopped, leaned on a shovel and just quit. And one of the fellow prisoners knew what he was experiencing. And that prisoner came over with his shovel and drew a cross in the dirt at Solzhenitsyn's feet. Solzhenitsyn said he looked at that cross and he remembered there is hope in Christ. God is here. And God can restore my fortunes. And he said in an instant, his entire being was energized. And he found the strength to go on by remembering the hope, the cross of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Father, what a beautiful picture this psalm gives us. One that we really need because all of us long for joy and we long to soar in life. And so, Father, we thank you for the beautiful picture of this psalm. And we pray that you'll enable us to do what this psalm calls us to do, to remember. We get so focused, Lord, we know, on all of the stuff of life and the ordeals and the trials and the things we want to accomplish and the stuff we think we need and the struggles and the hassles, and we forget you have done something great for us. Help us to remember that greatness of the gift you have given to us in Jesus Christ and to live in the reality of that, and help us then to put our hope in you in the future going forward so that we can soar. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen. John is going to pass out. We have these little COVID-free fellowship cups, communion cups. So you just take the the little top off, and there's a wafer there, and you can use that. But I just want to introduce, you know, the Lord's Supper. There's a Catholic priest, his name is Greg Boyle. He said communion is not for perfect people, but for hungry people. And that's a good thing for us to remember. I think sometimes people start thinking, well, I'm not worthy. Yeah, that's why Jesus Christ died on a cross, and that's what we remember in communion, is that we're not worthy and we need God's grace. And that's what we're celebrating. But I think it's interesting to think about these little communion elements. You know, if you think about hungry people, people who are literally hungry, you're literally physically hungry, these elements aren't going to help you much. You know, I'm really hungry. Well, this little wafer is not going to do a lot to take care of that problem. And I think that's appropriate because it reminds us that what we need isn't going to be satisfied by physical things. The power of these elements is not the physical elements. It's the symbol. It's what they represent. They form a picture that is crucial. We're trying to find satisfaction in life by consuming the things of this world. We will be as successful as trying to satisfy our hunger by eating this little wafer. These point us to something much greater. The satisfaction and the life that we long for has been given to us through Jesus Christ at enormous cost. He sacrificed for us so that we might have life. Pastor and author John Piper says, the purpose of the Lord's Supper is to receive from Christ the nourishment and strength and hope and joy that come from feasting our souls on all that he purchased for us on the cross, and especially his own fellowship. So this morning we're going to remember what Christ has done for us, and we're going to proclaim it, Paul said, and celebrate it by partaking these elements. So if you'll take the wafer, Jesus said, this is my body, take and eat, all of you. And in the same way, he took the cup, which represented his blood, and said, this is the blood of the covenant, shed on behalf of many for forgiveness of sins. Drink from it, all of you. Father, thank you for making a sacrifice that we will never truly comprehend on our behalf so that we might have life. Help us to remember that our life isn't found in things, in achievements, in anything in this world. Our life, true fulfillment, is found in our relationship with you and our fellowship with you that has been given to us as a gift through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. We thank you for that, Father. And we praise you for it now as we sing. We pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Well, please stand up as we sing, at the cross, I surrender my life. remember that God wants to be the wind under your wings. So delight yourself in him this week and have joy and great hope. So God bless all of you and all of you on Facebook, and have a great celebration this week, today and tomorrow. So we'll see you next week. Okay. 1, 2, there we go.